Hello and welcome. I'm going to be reviewing Devil May Cry cutscenes. All of them. Because why not? So this is just going to be a precursor to perhaps the final product. And overall, I'm just watching it right now. And just kind of saying overall, giving my overall critique of the game's cutscenes. Now you may be wondering, why don't I just review the game itself?
Yes, it's like, close of trading price.
Well, why should I really? I mean, no, the game is just kind of like blah. Nothing really happens.
Terms,
you know? I mean, well, the gameplay itself is just hack and slash.
No, this
and that's
is not
fine,
a
you know.
Threat.
Games can be whatever they want.
Should you fail
but
to comply?
I've just kind of noticed how very little story actually comes
sure
out through the gameplay.
Power.
It's just
shame,
kill, hack, slash, maybe use the guns because they're useless. And then you get a cutscene of 3 minutes of info or something
you
like that.
You have a good night, Mr. President.
Get it, my darling?
Over a trillion.
Oh.
Soon I will own everything worth a.
So, I actually kind of like and yet at the same time hate the villain. At least his design at this point. And I'm going to try to only divulge information as the story comes out. But I mean, it's just a typical fat, you know, bald guy. And obviously they're trying to allude to him being a banker or something like that. And that's fine and all. But.
A loose end, what?
I don't really get this introduction of Dante right here. Like, this scene in general doesn't really work. It works, you know, in establishing that he's obviously the villain and that she's his mistress. But it doesn't really make sense in the terms of.
Rip open his chest with my bare hands.
What's the word? Like, explaining why this. How does he know about Dante? Like. So, Dante, he killed Dante's mother when Dante was 7, which is what, like, let's just say Dante's 19 in this game. I mean, I guess if he's at a strip club, maybe he's 21, you know, because he's drinking beer and such. But, like, you know, how is it that there's a longer than 10-year lapse, and then all of a sudden, you know, 3 plus 10 plus 1 years later, all of a sudden he's like, oh shit, Dante, the son of the guy who killed his wife or something like that. And it's just like, why now? And why only Dante? Or maybe, you know, he doesn't really give out the name, but it does raise the question of why does he only sense, you know, one Nephilim or something like that? And why do they even have to use the word Nephilim? Is it that they're so beholden to the Devil May Cry franchise? Now, I both like and dislike this opening cutscene or introduction scene of, you know, credits roll and things like that. It kind of shows that Dante is just sort of doesn't really care, lives his life meaninglessly, and has fun and such, and that's fine. But it also is kind of like, it does a great job of setting the tone, which is, you know, very tongue-in-cheek and sort of have fun, don't really ask deep, meaningful questions. But then there's this next scene where they kind of introduce the Fox News Bill O'Reilly character, and it's just very kind of like, what? Like, they're going from sort of, hey, let's have fun, threesome with strippers, to, yeah, you know, here's some heavy shit right here, some people rebelling against society.
Claims to represent an organization called The Order. Now, this group has claimed responsibility for several serious attacks in recent weeks. He is undoubtedly a traitor and a terrorist. And I, for one, am not for the death penalty.
Now, does that tattoo even matter? I guess that's supposed to be, like, where he gets his, you know, scythe and sword from. But, like, it doesn't really ever, like, come into play at all. I mean, when did he get that tattoo? When he was seven? Was he born with it? The birthmark? Now he's on to you.
What are you talking about?
And then we get the introduction of this weird female character. So, she's wearing a hood, and she's wearing a sweater, and you can kind of assume that to conceal herself from, you know, whoever may be watching or looking for, you know, dissenters in this crazy world of ours. But later on, you see that she's wearing hot pants, and it's just like, why? Like, of all the clothes to wear, why short shorts? And so now we just see that he's easily introduced into Limbo. But later on we see that he needs some squirrel semen in order to get into Limbo. And it just kind of raises the question of how is one brought into Limbo and things like that. And this also doesn't work for me. So the trailer was pulled from the middle, yet this is a very long scene or whatever of him, you know, sliding through the trailer. And then as we see him coming out, he comes out through the back of the trailer. So how was that trailer pulled from the middle, and then all of a sudden, he would have obviously had to have turned somewhere inside of the trailer in order for it to turn into a straight line. And look, they're introducing the villains.
Time for rebellion. Wanna fight? Go. White guns.
Screws Dante's guns. Ebony and Ivory. Yes. Anyway, I'm sure the guns really weren't Ebony, as important Ivory, in the previous series of Dante games, but it just always kind of feels weird how they have this scene, almost as if they're trying to make them seem important. And they just never really get mentioned or come up again. And then even in like the reviews I've seen, they're just, the guns are really kind of sort of loved and hated. They like the idea of them, but they hate the actual use of them. And I understand it because actually using guns in a hack and slash game kind of puts your enemies at a distance. I can phase into Limbo and communicate. So I'm always kind of confused by these sorts of scenes where, you know, a person's just talking to someone who isn't there, and there's all these other people just walking around them, ignoring the girl who's talking to herself.
I'm risking my life here for you. I want to help.
I don't need your help.
The Hunter has dragged you into Limbo. I can get you out.
I've been down here before. I know how.
He doesn't need your help because you're a woman, and you're in the summer apparently, or something like that, and you're wearing short shorts, but yet a complete hoodie.
Is that my coat?
Is this the scene where he screws up the Ferris wheel? So this is kind of confusing to me because, in a moment, we'll see that the Ferris wheel is spinning in real life, or the real world. But that doesn't make sense, because in the rest of the game, the world gets deformed and, sort of crinkled. Like here. But yet, when we go back to the game, or at least the Purgatory world, everything's sort of ripped up, like this. Like, how is that explained? Why doesn't that happen in the real world? And then here's the infamous white hair scene. I feel like this was actually done really early in the development stage, and this is before, I would actually want to be surprised if this was almost before like the whole backlash, even though the hair is different from the premiere trailer or the announcement trailer. But yeah, I never really understood that, because it's kind of like saying, haha, white hair is a dumb idea, and we're not going to listen to you, fans. And then later on in the game, he has white hair for double mode, and anything else, like any important scene, he has white hair. It's just like, it's sort of, you know, intellectual consistency problems, where it's like, haha, white hair's stupid, but here's white hair if
Game
you feel
over.
Like it.
Son of who?
So it looks like he didn't even need to listen to Cat, who was saying he can't handle a demon hunter. And what exactly makes him a demon hunter? Like,
calling me a son of a bitch, you wouldn't.
I don't get it. Like, how is he different from any of the other demons? Or maybe it's like bounty hunters, like bounties, but you know, you don't call bounty hunters human hunters. So could they call him like something else? Something that would like maybe fit into the story more? And then here's his magical necklace that he got from his mother. That's really not that magical, but you know, he just has it. Because he's sentimental on the inside. Awesome, so the whole world is a mess outside of Purgatory. But like, I don't really remember seeing this. Did this all happen with that one boss fight? Because the world looked pretty normal when Kat was talking to him right after his trailer got smashed.
He wants to meet.
Everybody's Please? Just walking around, feeling happy and such. And this is the part where Kat is asking him how much for a good time. And he's leaning into her car saying, you know, $50. I like how that cop car went by, and yet there's no police siren or anything, just the lights.
We know all about you, Dante.
But then again, cop cars don't always have to play their sirens.
Something to do with that masked freak on the net.
That's my boss.
Wonderful. Can't wait.
We're just receiving reports of a terrorist attack that's taken place at the Bellevue Pier in the Western District of the city. Police are asking the public to remain vigilant. Further, terrorist attacks could take place anywhere, anytime, and when you least expect it.
So...
We have your
I understand
sense,
that was like
Sparta.
A nice transition from
now,
the outside world into this room by having him watch the same thing on TV. But like, why would you put a speaker like that out in the real world? It would just be annoying for those people who are in your apartments watching porn.
Welcome to the Order.
Not what I was expecting.
That's the idea. The demons are amongst us, Dante.
So is the Order just Kat and Dante's brother Virgil? Because I never see anyone else.
We're fighting back.
It's just the loneliest resistance group ever.
We're a small handful of freedom fighters. We are the last and only line of defense.
Defense?
Now, is that camera owned by the evil demons, or is that Virgil's camera?
The demons and their collaborators, world leaders, bankers, pop stars. We can hit them where it hurts.
Dun 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 dun. Look, it's
Dante.
Are they gonna
really
fucking introduce
you?
This guy already?
Dante.
Look, it's Virgil.
You don't remember.
It really is Virgil.
No. You don't remember.
I don't remember you.
How much of your childhood?
I know in the original games, Virgil,
not much.
Well, just like in this one, is Dante's brother,
like?
But it's like.
They
okay.
told me I had a
so,
car accident
matter, really?
Amnesia. Age?
Like, I know it's
seven.
Like, yeah, we're brothers and we're gonna kill people.
Your point?
I like their laser-guided amnesia.
You are not human, Dante. All war is fought with deception, and you have been deceived. Your past has been hidden from you for a reason.
Rewind a bit, who are you again?
My name is Virgil. I established the Order to help find a way to fight the demons.
Besides swords and bullets, you mean?
Such weapons can win battles, but not the war. We use force, yes, but we also use intelligence, politics, propaganda.
You know, it's nice that they say, you know, weapons can win battles, but not the war. And then what do you do for the entire game?
The two of us
just
working together,
use swords and bullets.
That we can defeat them.
So that's what this is about. You need me to fight the demons, help you save the world.
What else were you planning on doing with your life?
You guys do seem really nice, but more of a loner type. Trust issues, work alone, that kind of thing.
Dante, I don't think you understand what is at stake.
If you want to leave, turn your back on me, I'm powerless to stop you.
I don't think anyone understands what's at stake.
Mistake.
It's just basically, just oh yeah,
mankind,
demons, they control
yes.
the world.
Makes you think
it's really bad. It's like, really, what do the demons do that's really so horrible? Yeah, they manipulate us in terms of, you know,
who you really
making
are.
Us drink drinks that make us docile. But, you know, what would really be so horrible if we weren't docile? And then it's like, okay, they're rich and they enslave us through debt. Alright. Cool. It's just... If these, like... What are they actually doing? Like, that's so horrible. Like, yes, they have these tools that to control us, but they're not actually doing anything, like, eating our hearts, maybe? You know? They only eat mother's hearts, duh. Yeah, only if they're angels, too.
This was your home.
I don't remember it.
Nice hat, Virgil.
Cat, open the gateway.
I actually really do like Virgil's design. It's sort of a nice juxtaposition to Dante's, you know, laid-back, low-brow outfit.
What are you doing?
Our world and Limbo are very closely superpositioned. They collide in places causing what we call rifts.
So, like, did Cat, like, pour the squirrel semen on the ground earlier when, you know... She and Dante were, you know, getting transported into the carnival world of Purgatory.
Smell too good. What's in the can?
A compound I created based on an old Wiccan recipe. Sea salt, shark oil, iron shavings.
Like, I just don't understand, like, how does one get into Purgatory? Do you have to be dragged into there by a demon? Or do you always have to, like, step into this weird squirrel semen such stuff?
No, it's your turn. Hell, I get back. We'll take care of that. Just be careful.
Now, why does Dante have to go alone in this scene? Really, why can't they go with him? I never understand this. Like, I know in a gameplay format, they basically just want it to be all you killing all these demons by yourself. But, like, why is it that you can never have help from anyone? Raw. Oh look, they're gonna watch him do things,
so
but
own.
They're not gonna help.
Well, show me your secrets.
So does his home look any different than in the real world? Because the real world house looked pretty decrepit as well.
I remember this place.
Oh, I guess the painting would have been more decrepit in the real world? I don't know. None of this really makes sense. Oh, and in Purgatory, he gets bookshelves, but no roof. Okay, now he gets a roof. Why is this roof now coming here? Are they trying to, like, do some kind of cut cross between, you know,
who
this is what the
you?
Real world looks like, and this is what Purgatory world looks like? But then,
Sparta.
It's weird because it almost should be backwards, where the real world is nice looking, but Purgatory is sort of a in ruins world. Yeah, you got a scythe. I don't really see the big point. Like, and you got some new looking enemies too.
This way, Dante. Okay. Can't catch me.
Now why are there little children memories running around?
That was me.
I guess they are there to lead Dante in terms of a gameplay experience, But for the actual reasoning, I don't understand that at all.
Is that Mom?
No. It doesn't matter. Like, okay, so she's an angel. I get that. And Dante is a brunette or black-haired person. And Virgil is an albino. But why is their mother a ginger? I don't understand genetics. I'm not a biologist. You know, in order to telegraph the sort of betrayal that happens later on in the game, I think it actually would have been more interesting if they both had their parents' hair. I don't know what would have been more interesting if, you know, the mother was black-haired or if the father was black-haired or, and, you know, one was white-haired. But it just would have been a little bit more interesting, you know, at least to have that sort of direct genetic trait, as opposed to just this sort of like, alright, ginger mother, no idea what the father looks like, and white and black haired children who fight in their underwear.
I had no idea of the danger we were in.
Oh look, that looks like black hair to me. So, a black haired guy and a ginger make white hair and black haired children. Now, I like how this scene actually morphs into that sort of, like, angry cloud face. But, I don't know, I kind of wish they did a slower pullback. But I understand there's only so much time to feel like wasting of the game players play.
She gave her life so that we could escape.
So why exactly did he kill the mother?
Forget what he did.
Like, what did she do? Other than, like, I understand that, you know, angels and demons aren't supposed to mix. But, like, you know, what's really her problem other than being an angel? And isn't it interesting how she's the only angel that shows up at all in this game? And, like, purgatory is just looted with demons? Like, why is it that we never see any kind of angels? Now he's back into the real world.
I've been looking for you for a long time now.
That doesn't really prove anything. I mean, just because, you know, you meet one person with white hair,
mother gave these to
your
us.
Brother could be a 50-year-old man. You don't know.
I think she knew that this moment would come, that we would find each other. And our father, Sparta.
How do you think you know that?
Forever. A fate worse than death, they say. He's never coming back.
So supposedly their father is being tortured.
I want to know more.
But yet, after they kill the main bad guy, they don't go help him or save him or anything. He's just been banished and they don't even say where. Like, maybe they originally meant to imply that he's banished to hell. But it's like, okay, well, you know, the next game can be called Dante's Inferno.
Remember this place?
Devil May Cry.
Yeah, I remember coming here.
DMC 2.
My mother used to bring us here. Tell me everything. Some things have always been.
Your mother used to bring you to your own house? That's cool.
There've always been demons. And there've always been a war. 9 millennia ago, one demon rose through the ranks to take power over the dark hordes. The strongest, cruelest, Mundus.
So for 9,000 years, Mundus has been
rise alone.
In control of demons?
At his right hand was his most trusted lieutenant. His blood brother. Sparta. But Sparta betrayed him. He fell in love with an angel, Eva.
So you know what would have been a little bit more interesting is if Mundus, you know,
But it happened.
He is aware that, you know,
came new life.
These two are twin his boys. Nephew in some sense, or at least he will be aware.
A hybrid of the warring.
But, like, it would have been interesting if Mundus had at least, like, tried to convert them to his side or something like that. No, and, you know, maybe even, like, portray their father as a horrible person.
Eva was murdered by his own hand. And for Sparta, he demanded a more brutal fate. Endless.
I really like the style of this game. I'm probably going to see that a couple more times. But I feel like whenever they need to tell a story with visuals, the visuals will always complement well. But unfortunately, the visuals will not necessarily always hold the story or carry the story to the viewer. And that's a bit of a shame, because I think they do a really great job of showing things in sort of a unique twist. Not necessarily original, but it's more conventional, but they just do a sort of inversion or
Mundus believed flip that only one child was born. But there were two Nephilim.
Of showing what you expect, but
Sparta armed his
it's
son.
At least unique to some extent.
The rebellion for Dante. The Yamato for Virgil.
Unique but not original? Yeah, whatever.
So, Mundus killed our mom and imprisoned our dad.
Yes.
And we're the offspring of angels and demons.
Demon father.
Wow, that's like pretty much boiler plot right there.
We are Nephilim. The only ones that can slay the Demon King.
Good.
How? Spotter. Fucking demon collaborators. You're being dragged into limbo. I'll find Kat. She'll get you out. Stand firm.
Now, why is only Dante being dragged into limbo? Like, what protects Virgil from going to limbo? I don't really necessarily understand that.
Silver Sachs Tower. The world's most powerful investment bank.
At least he went to go get Kat. That means everything's going to be fine now.
CEO, Kyle Ryder. A human vessel. The physical manifestation of Mundus, the Demon King.
Silver Sachs. Obviously an allusion to Goldman Sachs.
To Mundus, the world is a factory farm for human souls. And he likes to keep his animals monitored and docile. The monitoring is done by
so, factory farm for human souls, so that means they take human souls
CCTV cameras,
and do what with them?
The way he keeps us docile is a little more insidious.
What is it?
It's in your hand. Planet Earth's most popular soft drink, Virility. The demons have spiked it. It's okay. It has no effect on us, only humans.
But don't worry.
Phlebotomy in a can.
Only humans.
So what's the plan?
That's the Hellgate. A conduit from which Mundus
so,
draws
I mean,
power.
I know they don't go into the nutritional value of the Virility, Hellgate, the world's immortal. Best soft drink,
but, we get him away from
but
the Hellgate,
what if you're a diabetic so the rest. And you don't drink so sugar? Do because I'm assuming if it's a soft drink, there is probably sugar in it.
Mundus is petty.
You know, after maybe like 99% demon spike,
I believe we can draw
no
them.
Date rape drugs.
Okay, so
you know, maybe just
Mundus,
1% of sugar, 5 grams.
We do that by pissing him off.
Roughly speaking, yes.
And we piss him off by taking out the Raptor News Network and Virilla.
That's it.
Which one do you want to do first?
So I like that, you know, in order to control the world, all he needs is a soft drink company and a news company. So I mean, these are basically the three evils the game portrays. Soft drinks, banking, and news. That's how they portray it, really? Like, that's all? I don't know, I just... You figure there'd be like maybe a chief police boss or something, perhaps?
Oh, come on.
Now I know the game's supposed to be very, you know, only you can save the world, or hack and slash things at least.
That just seemed to drag on forever.
But what if, like, Kat followed you on your missions and was sort of like always saying, like, yeah, you go, Dante, things like that. Just sort of like anything where it's like you're not always alone because the writer wants you to be or something like that. Just something kind of interesting where it's not just only you.
Remember his face, people. If you see him, inform the police immediately.
but do not approach him. He has a history of physical violence and is a known sexual deviant. This is Bob Marcus, just doing God's work.
He's a known sexual deviant because sex is bad and things like that. He has threesomes with strippers. Stay away, or else he'll be a stripper.
As a child, I explored the whole facility unseen. I sensed a demon under the factory. A succubus. An ancient one. I believe it's the source of the psychotropic ingredient. That's what they use to control us.
An ancient succubus. So aren't succubi, you know, sort of these women who seduce people and then suck out their souls or blood or whatever it is that usually the succubi in the story want?
How do people actually fall for this crap?
If you're told something's true often, you tend to believe it. Told me I was crazy for seeing demons.
You know, I kind of dislike how they just sort of throw that in there, like, if you're told something enough, and it becomes true to you. I kind of would have liked to have maybe a deeper sort of delve into that. Like, I hate how Kat is just a shallow love interest. And, like, I like, though, how originally she just only likes Virgil, and, you know, she's just really kind of using you. Although they don't really telegraph that to the player, that's more of a personal interpretation. But it was just... I would have liked it if she was maybe a little bit deeper and didn't have Marilyn Manson, or who is it? Charles Manson, right? That's him. Charles Manson tattoo right in the middle of her forehead. Or unibrow, sorry.
So I chose my path and I lived by it. And after all that anger, violence, and death...
Look at Dante, he's a badass. He's like 12 women in one bed. I wonder if this scene of the police fighting him and then him... What is he doing? Cutting himself? Would have been more prominent in the game had the original announcement trailer been more well received. Because the original announcement trailer is him just being held captive in sort of an interrogation room and being interrogated behind a one-way mirror. So I think that just would have been a little bit more interesting to see where this game originally was intended to go. Or if really, maybe this is the exact game that was intended. It's just his hair is maybe a little bit shorter now.
There's a rift inside. This is where they store the merchandise ready for export. It's funny.
What is?
I expected it to be bigger. A lot bigger. But then, I was just a child when I was here. I was in limbo.
What are you doing here?
Escaping my nightmares.
So if she was here in limbo before, I wonder if that will really mean anything.
Here.
I kind of think that actually would have been a little bit nice time to at least allude to something, or at least expand on that story a little bit. But this is kind of a long cut scene where they've just been trying to explain, you know, making jokes about soft drinks, you know, being sexual enhancement and things like that. So look, now he's going into purgatory, which means aren't all these boxes flying off the shelf or something? No? Oh, okay.
Whew. Dante?
Down here.
Oh, good.
You're right. It's a lot bigger here in Limbo. What next?
Head back to the mixing room. I'll meet you there.
Obesity, stupidity, drink.
Thanks. Don't help or anything. So, they're in the soft drink company's headquarters, or at least manufacturing headquarters, and she's there all alone without the help of Dante.
What? in the shitting hell is going on.
So I've been thinking a little bit about this, and I've been wondering why don't they allow any of the fighting to happen in the real world? Why is it that it always has to be in this purgatory demon world? It's just kind of confusing to me, because it's like, you're almost missing out on a very fun place, you know? To give players some kind of grounded context for battles. Instead of just always having these sort of arbitrary, you know, pop-up rounded rooms or rounded fight floors where he just runs around and, you know, sort of cuts things up for a while. And I think it could work in, you know, a real-world environment where it would just be, you know, sort of like boxed in by buildings. Or, you know, the only way out could be a gate and things like that, or a wrought iron gate. So, you know, it could work in the real world context. And then, like, the final fight could be, you know, just him and one demon, and, like, he busts open the gate, or the iron gate, by just punching the demon through it or something badass like that.
How do I get down there?
Just anything other than just, alright, you're always trapped in the demon world, in this sort of rounded fight floor, where it's just, you have to run around and attack things.
You jump, I twist.
Are you serious?
Trust me.
I jump, you twist.
So I kind of like this next little bit of where they just sort of have him falling. Granted, it breaks my own immersion of the laws of physics, because, see, when you're falling for a certain amount of time, even if you land on sort of a sliding edge, you still have to face the impact of your fall, even if it is at an angle. It's sort of like saying you can jump 100 feet out of the air, and as long as you land on a skateboarding ramp, you'll be fine. Oh look, the title sequence is the monsters. I really like this demon, how it's just constantly vomiting the sprite or whatever stuff. I hate, though, how everyone knows that Dante is the son of Sparta. And it's just like, what does it even matter?
Want to kill me? You can't kill me! I'm 1,200 years old!
You don't look a day over 12,000.
Fuck you!
Fuck you!
So 1,200 years old. How old are soft drinks? I mean, their Coca-Cola is at least, you know, over 100 years old. They look Dante, you just got some Sprite on. Anyway, but, you know, Coca-Cola has been around since the 1800s. And if she's like 1,200 years old, what was she doing, you know, for the first, like, 1,000? Like, was she just peeing in everybody's water or river? I kind of like this death, even though it is a normal cutscene. It kind of makes you wonder, though, why would they put the succubus next to a giant fan? Like, maybe they could put, like, you know, a grate or something like that? Something to protect large objects getting thrown into the giant fan. It's gonna swirl and cut you up. And now they're just trying to show him being with, you know, sorts of all these political and fancy,
really?
Powerful people.
Must we talk about her?
Now, I don't know what she's trying to do right now over fixing her head. Like, at first I thought she, like, had her hair in a ponytail, and, you know, she was undoing it. But then I was like, oh, she's bald. You know, I know her character sort of, like, looks like this, but is that how it is? And it's just like, What was she doing with her hair? Or head. Sorry. Like, when he was fucking her, did he actually accidentally undo her, like, knot or whatever it is? Hey, Charles Manson, how are you?
I'd like to know who I'm risking life and limb with.
I like your little star. He's my brother who's trying to save the world.
What's your story? Listen, I never asked for your help, but you gave it, and I appreciate it.
And this is supposed to be a quiet moment. Will they try to build some kind of connection between Dante and Kat?
He rescued me. I was in a foster home.
Oh, really? Go on.
A demon.
Oh, you're taking your hood off?
Me most nights.
This must be serious.
Nightmares.
So your dad beat you.
I felt nothing.
I'm sorry. But I mean, you know, there were lots of beaten children. Granted, not all of them had the same severity of getting beaten. But at the same time, it's like, okay, what are you trying to tell me here?
He heard my cry for help.
Like, she obviously went to the purgatory world in order to escape her father, but what does it matter? Like, okay, that's fine. You know, only her mind could go there. So, like, basically she would just be, like, I don't know, when her father would beat her, would she just be, like, sort of, like, laying on the ground, lifeless? I mean, I just don't... I can't envision it, and that's sort of my problem.
You've done well. We've dealt with the succubus. That will have hurt Mundus and got his attention. Now to land the second blow. Disable Mundus' monitoring network. Raptor News Tower. Controlled by Mundus, they have a monopoly over the world's media. News, advertising, entertainment.
Mind control?
Yeah. And surveillance. They spy on the populace through their network of satellites, routers, and CCTV cameras.
Yeah, I noticed that bit. What's the plan?
Kat?
The Raptor News Network is run by a demon. Bob Arbus.
No, I really like the idea that the security cameras are actually these demons.
In that tower.
It's interesting, at least. You know, it's not, it's a little kind of blah, because it's sort of like, alright, if every security camera is a demon, like, that would get pretty boring. Like, do the demons have shifts for the security camera duty? Like, do they switch every 12 hours or something like that? Because I just kind of have a problem believing that these demons are, they always seem to be very kind of prideful, or at least not arrogant, but irrational, and just always wanting entertainment. And it just is always kind of making me wonder, like, you know, how do they control themselves and things like that? So now Dante will be upside down world. I actually really did like the upside down design of the whatever tower, news tower, I guess you could say. But it just, I felt like they didn't go far enough with it.
Well, Bob, now I get why your point of view is so upside down.
I like that little line right there, why his point of view is upside down. It's a nice pun in a sense, and I felt like this game overall, at least in the cutscenes, could use a little bit more tongue-in-cheek comedy. It just seems like they weren't really copying the old Dante enough. It's weird, because they do so much to try to connect this series to the original Devil May Cry series, but at the same time, they just do all these things where it's like, yeah, we're just going to change one little thing, but everything else will be the same.
I can feel you.
It's like, yeah, you know, like, if Dante had white hair right now, would the game really be that different?
Are you a prisoner of Mundus too?
I mean, I think it would actually be very well. And you could just call this a prequel, and everyone hated it's a prequel because people don't like prequels. But it would at least be, like, more connected, in a sense.
Will you help me?
But then again, didn't they already do a prequel where Dante killed his brother? Whatever.
I can help. If you help me first.
It's here.
Those flying bastards stole my eye. They torment me incessantly. I can't leave here without it. I'm trapped for eternity. Get me back my eye, and I'll take you to
now,
the
I actually
tower.
Like Phineas, or whatever his name is. I like how this series has a history of taking names of, I guess you could say, historical religious figures, and putting them into the story. Granted, a lot of the time the names are just completely meaningless, but it is at least nice that they throw that in there. Makes it seem like they tried to put thought into this. Whether or not they did is completely debatable.
Why am I doing this for a crusty old demon? Oh yeah, that's why. Got it. You must be the eye.
Got it. You must be the eye. Who's there?
It is I.
The eye. You have it? Have you?
See, another nice pun. It's just kind of weird how Dante has these sorts of small things. I like that animation right there where they have to turn his head because they don't have the animation capability to actually show him sticking his eye into his head.
Dante.
You know me?
No. See, again, everybody knows who Dante is. So he was 7 at the time, and now he's whatever. But, like, how does everybody know who Dante is? Like, was his father fucking an angel that big of a deal? I guess so, but at the same time, it's like, what does it matter? Like, was that the biggest problem they had for the past 9,000 years? Was one guy having sex with an angel? And then making two kids?
You said you'd take me to that tower.
Of course, my friend. Of course. This way.
You know, it would at least be interesting if, like, alright, so Dante's within at least 30-year range or whatever. So, what was his father doing for the first 8,970 years?
Whoa! Are you nuts?
I forget. You and I see things differently. Seeing things differently can open new paths.
Yeah, you know, monovision versus stereo vision. It has that effect.
Try opening your mind. It's all a matter of perspective.
It's like, thanks, asshole. Why couldn't you do that earlier? Just adjust your eyesight so that way I could have, you know, just a nice little walk Asiel. In the park here.
An ancient one. Nephilim, like you.
But I didn't know there
so
were
I wonder why they would build a statue to Asiel or sadly, the original Nephilim. Or maybe this was just originally a statue and they just threw it in the water. I really don't know. Because they really don't explain it. But it's like, alright, how many Nephilim were there originally? And then, like, okay, getting back to the whole only Nephilim can kill demon kings. What exactly makes one a demon king? Does he have to have subordinates? Like, I don't understand it. It doesn't make sense. And granted, that kind of works with the game's overall tradition of don't think too hard. There's really, the point is just to have fun. And that's fine, but if you're going to have a story, you can at least ask that it makes
Dante,
sense to some degree. That's just a personal
you.
Desire, but you know.
For that, I am truly sorry. Your father fell in love with me.
A love that transgressed rigid ancient boundaries.
Sure, it's all the man's fault. Always blame it on dudes. Annihilation.
We never regretted our choices, but we never gave you yours, my dear son. Now, finally, you will have that choice.
What was his choice?
You will have a great power.
What is his choice?
A power that will allow you to forge your own path.
So his choice is to have a great power? That's not much
that
of a choice.
Son is freedom.
Oh, he can forge his own path.
Be brave, my son.
Whoa.
That was wild.
Thanks, Mom. Thanks for that meaningful message.
You found your inner devil, all right. But you have yet to discover your full potential.
Mainly, I just want to kill the demon king.
I don't really get that. Like, shouldn't it be you found your inner angel?
Who would take his place?
Like, I wonder, did they originally split up these scenes? Like, the mother was supposed to be at the house, and the father was supposed to be in this sort of demon world purgatory. Because that would make a little bit more sense, because supposedly Bill O'Reilly likes to torture people. So that would have made more sense, at least in terms of the story, just a little bit. As opposed to being a portrait of the father makes you have superpowers.
You're not just like your father. I see your
and that kind of raises another question earlier, like, alright, so why didn't... When Virgil went through the house, did he get superpowers too? Like, why didn't he get a sight? And why does Virgil never, like, really fight anyone? Except he fights the demon hole. But we'll get back to that later.
His weakness is that he loves her?
Mundus? Love? No, my friend. Yet, she has recently become the most important thing in creation to him.
This is so I kind of dislike right here where they say, like, Mundus doesn't love, ha 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 ha. But he cares a lot about his child, or at least the fact that his mistress is carrying a child, an heir. It's like, well, what is love, really? I mean, it's just liking something a lot, or at least wanting something a lot. Like, the only reason why he does care about this woman is because she has a child who will eventually succeed him. And it's like, how long is his lifespan? 10,000 years? So, for the next 1,000, he's going to try to make a baby or something like that? Like, it just doesn't necessarily make sense in that context, where it's like, you know, he cares about her for this reason. Why is that not love, really? Like, yeah, he probably doesn't want to hear about her day, but does anyone want to hear about their significant other's day? I mean, she works in a brothel. Like, does he really want to hear about how she made one whore fuck 10 clients? Or how she fucked 10 clients at the same time? Oh look, another rounded fight floor.
Hey, Bob. Put a spin on this.
My personal view on the terrorists is that they are disgusting.
You know, I would like that if you did something
sleazy,
a little bit more interesting than just the middle finger.
Nauseating.
Earlier when he was fighting the succubus, or at least yelling at the succubus, where they're just like, fuck you, no, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you. It was...
I'm taking you off
I kind of dislike the word fuck
so?
Because it's such
I
a meaningless term.
You little shit.
Like... It has so many meanings that it is meaningless. It's just like, okay, fuck either means have sex with someone or that you dislike someone. Or dislike something. And it's just like, well, what does it matter? Like, why can't we just use the actual words? Like, I often have this problem where it's like, if you need to add fuck to make your sentence sound important, you may want to rethink the importance of your sentence. Like, there's this one band over where it's like, pull the fucking trigger, bitch, and that's like the chorus of the song, and it's like, what does it matter? like, it doesn't, like, what it, you're obviously trying to say that the woman should commit suicide or she should shoot someone, but it's like, what does it matter? Why did you need to add in fuck? Because to make it sound more theatrical, it just doesn't really matter at all.
You're fired.
Oh look, and now he uses the guns. So I wonder if Bob Barker, or whatever his name is, wasn't in front of the camera, does that mean he would have not been shot? They would have been A-okay? Oh look, now Dante gets some shuriken, or whatever these things are. Interesting how the animation goes through his fingers at one point. But whatever. Let's not pick on this game. Just supposed to have fun.
Make your next move, if you will.
Now, I kind of dislike the design of that investment building. Just because it's sort of too opulent. It's just like, how does that work in terms of architecture? It's just like... three, or is it a dove or something? It's a flame? I don't know. And it doesn't really matter, but it just feels almost...
I gotta get to them first.
The entire... it's surrounded by these buildings that are just very eyes. Kind of like...
come on my way.
Normal-ish, whatever. Just plain, square, rectangle, and box buildings. And then there's this sort of no-shape building that almost has a flame or wing aspect to it.
Cat!
Dante!
I'm here.
I don't know what to do.
Where's Virgil?
I don't know. He's probably in the server room, the Octagon, but he might be trapped in Limbo.
How do we get to him?
I don't know. I'm stuck in here.
Is there something I can do from Limbo to break you out? Think!
Oh. How do you get anywhere in this game? Oh, yeah, by killing 100 things and then... being able to progress in the next cutscene.
Thank you, Dante. Cat, you're still alive. Is there a way out of here?
You're not welcome.
Yes, there's an emergency gate. I'll take you there.
Let's go.
No, not yet.
What?
There are terabytes.
So I kind of like how Virgil doesn't really care whether or not Cat lives or dies. It's sort of nice. I kind of wish they took it a degree further. Not necessarily where he doesn't... he's almost... he almost hurts her. But in the sense of just his overall outlook towards humans. I think... I wish they had, like, kind of telegraphed that a little bit more. And just sort of how disdainful he is of them. And how, like... I guess you could say that their purpose is only to serve them.
They're almost through.
Let's go, Dante. Wait. What about Kat?
There's no way out in the real world.
No, we can't help her. Let's go.
So, why can't they stay and fight? Like, just tell Kat to get behind some boxes or something. And then just, like, have them fight, get in the real world, and then fight the police. Because I don't, you know, they've been fighting demons this whole time. I don't know if humans would be so hard. Will probably hurt you a lot. Like, it's just so blah. Like, none of this matters. Does anything matter? Probably not. So they shoot her. Originally, I thought they shot her with like a dot, or not dot, a stun gun, or not a stun gun, but dart, that's it. Not dot. Stun gun. But no, I thought they shot her with a tranquilizer dot. And like, are they kicking her now, or what are they doing? And why aren't they just handcuffing her? Like, you know, it's not like they really have to do anything. Oh, thank God they got her out of the room in time. Look, now Virgil will protect Dante, in a sense. So this is a shield, and I wonder, can you actually do like some kind of shield spell in the game? Or is it just you always have to cut things off?
say the name.
Better not be over. It's only been an hour of cutscenes.
Say the name.
So now they are watching Kat on Skype, and they're just going to do that, because why not?
Bird, I don't know who you are, or why you have been stupid enough to attack me. But I know...
I don't even know who Virgil
means
is.
...something to this girl. So I suspect this girl means something to you. I also know...
I kind of like that deduction. You know, it's not just like, I know this girl means something to you. It's, you know, yeah, you mean something to this girl, so I guess she means something to you. Because the resistance is only you and her. Like, why couldn't they just give him a bunch of underlings, and then he could be like a half-demon king? I just don't understand so much of the logic of this game. And granted, you're not really supposed to question it. It's just supposed to have fun.
Not that I'm your brother.
And that's the thing, is I don't think this game has enough fun in it. It's just, you know... Yeah, it's so kind of blah serious. It just, I don't know. But at the same time, it's like, would a constantly wisecracking Dante really work in this game?
You can't seriously think that I would trade your life for hers.
No, I'm not saying.
Apart from the fact that you're my brother, you're the key to destroying.
I'm not saying we trade me for her. I'm saying we offer another trade. Captain Mundus' mistress, Lilith.
Why would Mundus care about one of his whores?
Because she carries his child.
How can you know this?
Now, I kind of like this, because it sort of changes the dynamic of the two relationship between Dante and Virgil. Where Virgil's like always a sort of conniving, scheming tactician. Now Dante has some information that Virgil doesn't. And it sort of, you know, makes it a little bit more interesting. Where it's not just Virgil constantly giving orders, even though that's what will happen as soon as this cutscene ends.
Of mankind for a girl. Cat put herself through hell to protect us. We'll find another way to get Mundus.
Dante.
I'm not abandoning her.
I can see that.
Yeah, what does it matter if you do or don't abandon her?
Do
it's not like you have a choice anyway.
There it is. Mundus' mistress, Lilith, runs an exclusive club downtown for high society. Sports personalities, rich kids, bankers, that kind of thing.
Yeah, because we need a fourth boss fight.
She hooks the pathetic weasels on this stuff. Turning them into soulless demon collaborators.
Whoa, she'll be there tonight. You're not coming in. You're not on the list.
Now, like this scene right here. I feel like the game really needed a lot more of this. Even though he just writes down fuck you on the thing. I kind of wish he wrote down something else, but... I don't know, I'm alright with fuck you. It's just like, whatever. It fits his sort of dumbass style. And I like how... I kind of hate that this was like the club that he was at earlier. Because it's like, alright, so... if only she had seen him, or if only she had been there instead of with Mundus the night when he realized that Dante exists. I mean, it just would have been like so much more alright. And pretty much, if Mundus had done nothing, Dante would have never have shown up.
Dante's here.
Like, if Mundus had not sent the Demon Hunter after Dante, none of this would have happened so far. Kat wouldn't have shown up, because we still don't know really how Kat found out about Dante. We can kind of assume that it was because the Demon Hunter was going to show up. But, you know, it's a nice little irony. But at the same time, it's like, this makes no sense.
You wanna dance? Let's dance! Your turn, Barbie.
Yes! This is exactly the opportunity I've been waiting for! Come on, baby, let's make Daddy proud!
So, while she was watching, you know, those demons fight Dante in the previous battle cutscene, whatever, why couldn't she, like, call the cops and be like, Dante's here? Because apparently he can't, like, kill real humans or anything like that. And I'm assuming he's in purgatory right now. So how exactly, like, did he get transported there randomly? Do, like, other demons have the ability just to throw anyone they want into purgatory? I don't really understand. This game makes no sense. The story makes no sense. And now this woman's about to get sucked up into her own fetus. So do those squares just get thrown up into the ceiling now too? And those columns? Mundus spawn. Or Mundus's spawn. I like that they did the actual apostrophe there. So that was a nice little joke. I think they should have went further, maybe like a little bit of dead baby comedy. But I understand that they have to make this as a commercial product to appeal to people.
Get up.
And not end up as on Fox News for whatever.
I'll let you both live if you do exactly as I say.
I swear, I'm nothing without this brat.
Now pull yourself together.
So I like how she kind of acknowledges her uselessness, in a sense. But at the same time, it's like, well, why can't she keep fighting? Like, the baby is the one that lost the battle, right?
Regarding your trade offer, I'd like to suggest a counter proposal. The life of the girl. For the life of your child.
I kind of would like if they said something like, the life of the girl for the life of two. Or you get a special deal, Mundus. We're offering you the price of one for two. Or two for one. And that would have been a little bit more interesting. Like, it would have kept up with Dante's sort of tongue-in-cheek personality joking style. Which I feel this game kind of lacks a little bit. Like, yeah, there's some kind of jokes where they, like, just say, fuck you, and it's like, it is I, and he's holding an eyeball. But, you know, overall, I feel like the game needed a bigger sense of humor. So there's about, what, six guards, or six SWAT team members, versus one Virgil, and one Dante. Between them, they have three guns. Now, I would have liked it if they actually had said something, or, like, if Dante had said something kind of smart-alecky. Like, I hope you have your walking shoes on, cat. Like, they're just throwing her around in her short shorts, and it's just like, why, what does any of this matter? And I always wondered, why isn't there like a sniper hidden somewhere? Like, this is a perfect place to have a sniper just randomly hidden. Or even maybe some guy with a rocket launcher. Or maybe even a guy with some rockets on his boat. I mean, there's just so much that they could do where it's just like, why is it only six SWAT team members? I mean, could they just do something like, you know, these boots were made for walking Barbie, so get out of here. Why does this have to be such a serious scene? And why is the mistress walking, but the cat's just kind of standing there, sort of slowly walking? And then in the next cutscene, we'll like kind of see them both like half and half at the waypoint. I actually really do like the fact that they did kill the baby or something like that right now. I don't like that he just says, what the fuck? I really like it. He said, why the hell did you do that? Maybe something like that. Something more than WTF. And then why is her body like change or shift? Whatever. And now look, it's two of them versus six of them. And it's alright if they live, but I would have liked it more if like Kat had been in danger. Obviously she's not because she has plot armor surrounding her. But it's like, come on, anything, please. To like give it some tension or point or meaning. And I kind of like how Dante's at least getting shot in the back and they show these sort of bursts of blood dust or whatever. But at the same time, it's like, alright, so it doesn't affect him at all. So he's invincible. So what's the point of him this? Why doesn't he just like run over there and just chop up all the SWAT team members? It's completely meaningless. And this is another thing I don't understand. Alright, so he's running around right now. I'm assuming that now there's a sort of platforming part of the game. Maybe it's even timed. But it's like, okay, so they're up in the air, and now Dante has to run over there really fast. And I'm not sure if anybody has their seatbelt on. I don't know if they're not gonna make it so much as they're gonna hit that thing in front of them. It's like, okay, see, now Dante's, like, following them. But he just ended up on top of the car. Like, that's the point of the scene. He ends up on top of the car after not getting in the car.
So the Hellgate.
And now Kat kind of sort of remembers the thing. Even though, isn't she, like, a psychic medium?
It can only be reached from his chamber.
So, like, was she punched in the nose, or has her nose always been that pain?
Still weak from his last outburst. This is your chance to defeat him. Mundus doesn't know that Virgil is Nephilim. We can use that to our advantage.
Blah.
There's a back door into the tower located here. Virgil, you must reach the security.
And I kind of like this scene right here where they show, like, you know, like, here's a blueprint of what we're going to do.
Hey guys,
and it's spliced along in what they're actually going to do.
Here I am.
Just like your father. Too big for your fucking boots. Me? A god.
What does that really mean? Too big for your fucking boots? Like, his ego is too big? I thought you were a king demon. I know it's just like supposed to be him having an inflated ego. Both of them. But at the same time, it's like, okay, why? What does it matter? Look, now Virgil's gonna do some hacking stuff because that's all he does in the game.
Come to me, Dante. If you can, I'll be waiting for you.
Cool story, bro.
Made it. We made quite the team.
What? Why is Virgil not in limbo or purgatory or whatever? Like, why do they have to like be in different places? Why can't they help each other?
So keep them waiting.
I mean, I like this like little thing right here where they're fighting with each other. Like, I'm smarter, I'm better looking, and then it ends with I got a bigger dick. Like, it fits within the term of like their lowbrow humor of the game, but I don't know, I would have liked it more if it ended somewhere else. Like, still low, and still stupid,
you lure him out.
at least maybe a little bit more inventive than penis size.
Then we go for the kill.
Any ideas how I draw him out?
We killed his unborn child. Get him rabbit.
Got it.
But do not try and kill him.
I always feel like
he's immortal until I shut down the hellgate.
I kind of wish he pronounced it like Yamato.
This is it, Dante.
Yamato.
We have to put our lives into each
something
other's
else.
Hands completely,
it just
without
feels
hesitation.
Weird.
We are brothers, after all.
Is that why you're just gonna stand outside and wait for me to do all the dirty work, Virgil? So I kind of like how this conversation between the two begins. Mundus is very calm and collected, and he just wants information, while Dante is just trying to think.
I will ask you again.
But he can't because he's a dumbass.
Why did you kill my child?
Because you killed my mother.
So it was revenge. I see.
It was more than that.
Oh?
It was for freedom.
Freedom. Now you seem to have all the freedom.
Freedom.
You need.
Sure, whatever.
The freedom,
Mel Gibson.
To murder my heir.
Go back to your fucking Braveheart movie.
I'm not talking about my freedom. I'm talking about mankind's.
Mankind.
Actually, isn't this
and
game about your freedom?
Freedom
like
you
that's
suppose.
What your mother said, right? The freedom of choice, the freedom to have power, or something like that.
Because when I arrived, they had.
I don't know. See, that's the thing, is like the game is trying to have a message, but it gets so muddled with its writing and its dialogue.
They fought. They killed. They starved. That brought prosperity. Brought structure. What have you brought? Besides violence, war, death.
Have you really brought prosperity out of debt? I don't understand.
On,
I mean,
Dante.
I kind of dislike that, where he's like, what have you brought? Death and war. And it's like, well, the gameplay developers don't really give the player any other tools
right.
Other than chopping up demons.
It was mankind. It was,
like, it's kind of like that sort of...
I gotta tell you.
I don't know, it almost reminds me of Spec Ops: The
like
Line.
That?
Where it's like, you know,
it
why'd you kill all those innocent people?
Like
but,
bitches?
You know, it's like, you can't do anything else. You don't have the Christ contextual power to do anything. Like, say, hey, don't shoot. I want to let you live. But if you do anything, I'll hurt you. It just kind of bothers me in that sense, where it just makes me completely detached from the story and from any kind of meaning the game is trying to give me. I kind of like that look. I kind of wish, though, that Dante ran back in just to say, like, you're stupid and you're ugly, Mundus. And then, you know... Because the look that Virgil kind of gives him right there is sort of like a, wow, that went well. You want to try for round two, jackass? And then there's just sort of this, where he's just putting his hands on his chest, because he's like Arnold Schwarzenegger. He loves to grow up the ladies. Granted, it does kind of harken back to earlier where he's like, I want to rip open their rib cage and feast on their heart.
Down.
But at the same time, it's like, whatever. Now this I kind of really hate, because all Virgil does is stick his sword into the hell mouth. Like, what, is this like some kind of Freudian penis envy sexual excuse? Like taking your mother's toys and putting them into somebody else's hole. I mean, seriously, look, this is just a completely sort of metaphor for sex in a degree. And it's just like, whatever. Oh look, now people can see demons. Shit's gonna get cray cray. I don't know. What has anyone
leave
done?
My brother alone.
Oh look, now Virgil's all the way back over here. That was pretty quick, Virgil. Thanks. Oh, leave your brother alone. That's cool. You know, I really hate how, like, Virgil really, or I mean, Dante couldn't really do anything. It was just sort of like...
You okay, Dante?
You took your time.
Is that Virgil's car they just smashed into? I don't know. It looked like the same car. I think it's kind of interesting that they don't really show any humans die. Like, yeah, you just saw some people get sucked into, like, a bunch of concrete, but we don't actually, you know, we see a demon get shot and kind of, like, you know, kill lots of demons, but we don't actually see any humans or anything. Like, even Kat, like, when she was being, not really interrogated, but just sitting there, like, it was kind of implied that she was previously tortured, but we don't really see anything.
Kill him now?
Alligator's shut.
You will die.
Never! Any ideas? You see that eye of his? Yes. His demon child had something like that. We start there. We'll have to get it open.
I do kind of like that though, where it's like
keep
they're sort of giving
I'll try and get the eye exposed.
This gameplay about how to defeat the boss.
Don't attack him.
Kind of
just stay alive until I expose
spot.
His eye.
Sort of like having him throw his arm all the way back and then punch him forward into the ground. Or building, whatever. Oh, great throw, Virgil. Get a lot of work here. And of course, Dante cuts him off. Cool. I actually do like the way that this boss ending looks. I don't really like the whole kind of boss that he did. But I do like, at least, this is a very visually pretty game, and I wish it didn't have to get bogged down so much, and people being like, ugh, his hair isn't white, but at the same time, I would have kind of liked it if they did. Overall, I don't care, but at the same time, it's just like, why did they change anything? Like, this game works on its own. You know, they could almost say, like, the world is Dante and Virgil's fault for... making humans aware of demons. It would almost work in that sense. Look, they're brothers, and their teamwork worked. Or something. Oh my god, there's Twitter! What the fuck? What the fuck? What WTF? WTF? Text my from bro in Russia. Holy shit! Demons. Yeah. Now how did they actually get that close up to those demons to get, like, a picture of their face? Like, my camera has a zoom feature, but it really sucks. Possibly because it's an iPhone. But we don't know. We have awoken! Wait, why did that really form into that? That wasn't really like a theme of the game. Why'd that have to be shown?
What's hidden is now laid bare for all to
see. Who knows? Does any of this make sense?
Revolution is in the air.
I never believed I'd live to see this day.
So I don't know, do you want to live in this world versus your sprite drinking bank debt world where you have a house?
Path is clear for us to rule. What did you just say? The path is clear.
Yeah,
for
we're
us
all
to
as
rule.
Shocked as you guys.
To
like,
what?
Where the hell did this whole let's rule thing this? Come from? Everything. It doesn't really make sense. And it's like, yeah, two
mean,
rule what?
Like
what's
months.
The difference between you and the other guys?
No.
Like, what was the difference between
be
you guys
like
and maybe
months.
Even humans?
We'll
like, I obviously get that they're trying to promote
them.
Self-determination, yes. But it's like
easier.
Every state has a police.
I mean, humans.
So I guess every state is a police state, yes? But then, what does it really matter? As long as they're a sort of overall authority. Who? What does it matter who rules?
Humans are frail. They're like children. They need protection.
Humans are frail, so therefore we should rule over them. Like, again, I don't really necessarily get why is Virgil so intent on ruling?
A human.
Like, what does it matter to him? Like,
Cap was useful, but
I'm assuming he's on par with
Cat
Dante's power. But what does it matter who rules or why? Like, Cat, what does Virgil want, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. Gold?
Listen,
money? I mean, obviously power, but what is he going to use the power for? What does he need to change? Does he need to give universal health care to everyone? Does he want there to be monuments built to him? It just is very unclear why Virgil is doing what he does. And I guess it's kind of the thing with every character in this game is we don't really know what their intentions are. Even Dante, like, he's just an idiot who likes to drink and go have threesomes with strippers. He doesn't really have any kind of meaning to his life beyond that. And that's fine, but at the same time, it's like, alright, why should we really care then? Like, Dante has just been a pawn this whole time. And then here's where, so like, Virgil's always carrying his sword, I think. I don't know if I've seen a scene with him where he doesn't have a sword, other than when he's wearing a sweater. But Dante's sword, or scythe, or whatever, always kind of materializes out of nowhere. And it's kind of assumed that it's because of his tattoo on his back. But it's like, why? What does it matter? Does this even need to be here? That's a very weird stance, to have your sword facing your opponent, as opposed to facing your back, so that you can easily draw it towards your opponent. Oh look, Dante won. And he has white hair. So you see, that's kind of the thing, is like, this game sort of mirrors the beginning in a lot of ways, where at first he didn't have a reason for doing anything, now his reason is just to reject authority. Which is okay, but at the same time, it's like, what? Why? And then, like, at the same time, you know, he doesn't have white hair, or at least they show him wearing a wig, and he's like 9 years. And now they show him wearing a wig, or not really wearing a wig, but having white hair. And it's like, you break your own intellectual consistency in making fun of the things that you have in your own game. So, Kat doesn't want Dante to kill Virgil for her, but it's like, there's already a sword through his chest. Like, if that doesn't kill you, what would kill Virgil? Other than a cutscene. Oh look, it symbolizes that other earlier cutscene we saw of them being boys and holding or shaking hands.
The world is under my protection now.
You've chosen the wrong side. You're not human, Dante. You never will be.
What does it matter what side you guys are on? You guys can cut buildings in half. Like, I don't understand, like, what is it that you want? What's the point of any of this? Go get half of your remaining jacket, skirt, you douche. How? You knew him for like an hour. Like, when did Virgil find out about Dante? Just this game throws up so many questions that are just not answered at all. In terms of its story. And they don't necessarily need to be told, but at the same time, it's like the logic of this game makes no sense. And now he never gets his black hair back, and that's fine, but at the same time, it's like, okay, Now it ends with him having purple eyes,